तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहैः। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। So now, the next few verses are talking about the place of meditation in this whole pursuit. Okay? So now you can ask a question that if I'm already free, if that is my nature, okay, and in order to prepare myself, I'm living a life of karma yoga, then what is the place of meditation? What value added does meditation have in this whole pursuit of knowledge? Okay. So let's look at the next two verses. It explains the whole purpose of meditation and how meditation as envisaged by Vedanta is different from other techniques of meditation that we are generally used to. Okay. So I will chant and you will chant. You will chant after me. First I'll chant the whole verse and you chant after. स्पर्शान् कृत्वान् बहिर्बाह्यान् चक्षुश्चैवान्तरे भ्रुवोः प्राणापानं समौ कृत्वा नास्याभ्यन्तरचारिणौ। नौ रिपीट आफ्टर् मी। स्पर्शान् कृत्वान् बहिर्बाह्यान् चक्षुश्चैवान्तरे भ्रुवोः प्राणापानौ समौ कृत्वा नास्याभ्यन्तरचारिणौ यतेन्द्रियमनोबुद्धिः
मुनिर्मोक्षपरायणः
विगते चापय क्रोधः यः सदा मुक्त एव सः। सो डिफरेंट स्टेप्स ऑफ मेडिटेशन एंड देयर पर्पसेस आर एक्सप्लेन थ्रू दीज टू वर्सेस। ओके, सो इन जनरल यू नीड टू नो टू थिंग्स दैट इवन टू बी एबल टू थिंक अबाउट दिस रियलिटी इन इट्स टोटालिटी एंड connect the nature of I, the universe, the cause of the universe and the growth and everything and make a coherent picture, you need to first understand each part of the vision accurately and then connect each part with the other part accurately. So that means all these different information, generally what happens is we either partially understand or even if we understand one thing, we don't know how it connects to. So you want to know this?
No, it's okay.
It's okay. And then how it connects to the other part, right? So that you make a, it's like a, you know, jigsaw puzzle. You have one part here, one part here, one part here, one part here, but you still don't have the totality of the picture. So when do you have the totality of the picture? When the entire thing is done and all parts are connected with the other, right? So this is exactly the same thing. Even though we are talking about knowing realities which are already there, it takes time for us to comprehend. Why? Because your comprehension has to be as accurate as what the reality is. You can't afford to create a different picture than what there is. And you have to connect each part of the vision to make a coherent vision. Okay? So now, generally what happens is, when we try to understand a few things in life, there are two kinds of problems. One is, we lack concentration to do what? Really stay with a given subject matter, the mind wanders. And this is something that we see even in a class. You sit in a physics class or you all are professors. you immediately know, I'm sure, when the student is attentive and when the mind of a student wanders. Okay? So that means that it's not that the student is deliberately doing it. What happens? It just happens, right? So therefore, this is the first problem that people have, which is what? Lack of concentration. They are unable to stay with a given subject matter for a length of time. Immediately you move somewhere else. That is the first problem. Okay? And the second problem is that we generally understand things at a superficial level. Okay? So that's why we have a semblance of knowing. We think we know, but we don't really go deep into the subject matter, think about it from all different possible standpoints and make sure that we understand it accurately. Okay? So that's why also you see that people, very often people say, oh, I understand all this, but I'm not able to live this life, right? But many times they have not really understood all the implications with all totality, but they think that they understand. So now you also need to develop a mind which is able to stay with the ideas, okay, and see them from all possible angles and to see in depth rather than at that certain superficial level. Okay, so now how do you create a mind which is able to dwell onto any given topic in depth and also not just lose concentration and move to other topics? So this is where meditation comes into play, because it prepares you to have that type of a mind which is then able to understand things accurately and think about things more deeply. Okay? So this is where, and what are the steps to this meditation? This is what is said. How do you start the meditation to have a deeper mind, a mind which is able to see the connections well and also is not what getting distracted? Okay? So the first step, as Lord Krishna is saying, sparshan krutva bahir bahya. Okay? This is something which is very interesting. He says there are external objects, okay, and keeping them external. But the external objects are already external. Why do you need to keep them external? Because very often, what happens? External objects, you what? Carry in your mind. Right? You don't leave people out there, especially the people who bother you. They occupy your mind. Mm. You know, even if you don't like somebody, that person doesn't bother you if you're not constantly, what causes the problem is what? You're dwelling on that same person. In fact, the person that you don't like, you dwell on a lot more than the person that you like.
They visit your dreams also.
Yeah, they visit your dreams also. Right? So that means that the person is outside, but where are you carrying the person? Inside. And that carrying that person inside leads to a lot of suffering. Okay? So in fact, you can be dealing with one colleague, let's say at work, for how many hours in a day? Even if you don't get along with that colleague, how many hours you physically spend with that colleague?
At the most an hour.
At the most an hour. Okay? And a lot, sometimes if you don't like that person totally consumes you in terms of your mental life. How many hours you spend and putting a tape again and again and again, what happened and what he said and how you were so upset and how, you know, your mind just keeps on putting that tape. It's like, you know, this recorder that we used to have, and then it gets stuck. And then what happens? This, you know, old,
needle gets stuck.
Needle gets stuck, and what happens? Same story again and again. And this is how our mind is. Okay? We keep on dwelling on the same story, and every time we make it bigger and bigger and bigger, and every time our suffering increases. So this is where he says, first thing is to say that sparshan, bahir krutva. The external world remains external, and you tell yourself that in meditation, this is a time that I have for myself. Not as connected to different people or different situations. We have all these hoodies. So all that you tell yourself that this is a time, 15 minutes, half an hour, this is me with relation to me, not with external world. How many hours in the waking we spend just with ourselves, being with ourselves?
Hardly any time.
Hardly any time. So where is that healing time? Tell me. You're constantly bombarded with external stimuli, situations and all. Where is that?
Bonding with yourself.
Exactly. Where do you just stay with yourself, heal yourself, rejuvenate yourself? There is no time. We don't have any time for that. We don't allocate any time for that. So here you say, now this is a precious time for me, for myself. The only time that we find us without relationship to the world is what? When we go to sleep. And this is why initially during meditation, what happens? When you begin to relax, the only time that we are used to relaxing is what? At the time of sleep. So immediately the mind goes, you fall asleep. Because you have never experienced being awake and being totally relaxed.
True.
Right? So this is where you first say that now this is totally relaxing time for me. This is my rejuvenation time for myself. Okay? And leave the whole world outside for 15 minutes. You don't need to carry the whole world within you all the time. Okay? So this is what he says, Sparsha Krutva Bhagir Bhagya Chakshur Evantaretuva. And then he says that the eyes are kind of focused on the forehead. Okay. Now this is something that, you know, where you're, if you see, sometimes if the person is a little bit disturbed, two places that you can see, if the person is like, you know, all agitated around the eyes, and the second is what? Breathing. Mm. The breathing becomes irregular, it becomes shallow, it all becomes. So these are two different ways of what? Just relaxing yourself. Okay? So certain physical aid, you watch your breathing. By watching your breathing, what happens? Automatically all these irregularities will be checked.
Settled.
Yeah, absolutely. And as it becomes more harmonious, what immediately you will find that your mind calms down. There is a big relationship between breathing and the mind. That's why you go to a medical doctor in the US and let's say you are all stressed out, a lot of exercises will be breathing related. Okay? Because your breathing and mind are connected. So that means if you want to calm your mind, you look at the breathing. And this is what our pranayama, this whole yoga practice of pranayama is all about breathing. Okay? So that's what you do. And then you not only look here, but there is another technique that we do where you scan your physical body. Okay? You go to each part of your body because a lot of stress is not only mental, you also store it in your physical body. Okay? Very often you see your shoulders are like that, your back, your spine is not straight. All the tensions are held in your body. So this is one way to just scanning the body is being aware of each part and letting all the tensions go.
In fact, when I started doing that for the first time,
yeah,
I certainly remember I have not thought of my left elbow for a long time.
Yeah.
Not even you take it for granted.
Or sometimes what happens is, you know, when you become aware, then the pains become more acute. Because before you're like, your attention is not even there. Now you're paying attention, actually it is telling you. There's a whole body intelligence system which is constantly communicating with you. But what happens? We totally ignore that intelligence. We don't take the signals because we are not available to receive any signals. Okay? So now you begin to see that there is this whole intelligent mechanism. This is the biggest asset that we have. Okay? And you try to what? Use it in a maximum efficient manner. In order to make it efficient, what do you need to do? You need to first relax it, and you need to what? Give energy to all the parts which are fatigued, which are stressed, which are feeling pain. You just have to be kind to, and that is one good way to learn to be kind with yourself. So much, you know, no matter who the person is, we at times tell ourselves so many messages about ourselves which are self-depreciating.
We are the biggest critic of ourselves.
You know, we are not kind with ourselves. We are not understanding, we are not caring towards ourselves. Right? We constantly keep on judging ourselves and, you know, I'm no good and I'm like this and I should. It's all just, you know, this one pressure after the other. By paying attention to the body, you're actually telling that I'm worth spending time with.
It is true, isn't it? If, suppose I praise you.
Yeah.
But you don't think you're worth it, it doesn't matter.
But it doesn't matter, exactly. So, in fact, we want to hear praise because what? We never actually praise ourselves. And this is where, in fact, what was very interesting is when I initially met my teacher, so I was asking him many questions and he says, ah, you're a smart girl, you're asking so many questions. And I said, no, Swamiji, I'm not. He says, why are you saying that? Say yes, why not? Right? We always like, no, I'm not like that. But why not? Right? If you, what happens is we think that it is an ego. It's not ego.
No, we do not want challenges.
See, the thing is, there is a big difference between self-nurturing and ego. When is it ego? When do we say there is, in Sanskrit we use the word manitvam. Manitvam is that when you are proud. Okay? That is what? That you begin to think that you are exactly. You know, that you are this and you are that and you start looking down.
You are better than others.
Exactly. So this is either intellectually better than others or what? Looks wise better than others, or sometimes you have a spiritual ego. You think that, oh, I'm more spiritually evolved than others. So these are all different egos manifesting in different ways. Okay? That somehow you make yourself believe that you're superior than others. But that is not needed. One thing is not to have that, along with superiority complex comes what? You look down on others, right? So this is a problem. But to have a good self-image is not having superiority complex, right? Good self-image, a nurtured self, is not ego. Please understand that. And in fact, you need a healthy ego for Vedanta. If you don't feel good about yourself,
is it a difference between good and better? Instead of comparison, you just evaluate yourself.
Yeah. And that's what I'm saying.
Again, the past.
How does one get a good, healthy self-image without crossing that line of pride? How?
Repeat question.
Sorry?
Repeat your question.
Yeah. The question is, we think that appreciating ourselves is ego. It's not. Appreciating ourselves is very healthy way of living. Because if you don't appreciate yourself, how will you appreciate others?
If you are not kind to yourself,
the kindness,
you can't be.
Compassion, all these values, it starts with oneself. If you are not feeling good about yourself, you can't be compassionate to others. Okay? Because you have a sense of lack. You can't give. When you are operating from sense of lack, you only want to get to fill that sense of lack.
If you feel
relatively full, then what? You can extend yourself. So the first thing is to heal yourself. Because only when you really heal yourself, you can be kind to others. There is no such thing of being kind to others if you are not kind to yourself.
True. can't give what you don't have.
Yeah, absolutely. Right? So that means we are talking about the first step is to build a healthy self-image and also what? Nurture yourself. It's very important of because then all these values that we talk about become natural. You don't even need to work hard to get it. It all becomes natural. Natural expression of a person who feels good about oneself. Okay. So therefore, right?
Breakthrough.
Okay, please. Yeah. So this is
so
where
I'll give you my feelings, you know, in the sense that I see somebody being very nice or very kind or very the ability to see things and I say, wow, I wish I was like that.
That is lovely. That is very nice. Because one thing, this is a very nice example, right? You see somebody is good at something, okay? Generally what happens if you are not confident about yourself, what happens is on one hand you see a good quality, but on the other hand what it creates jealousy.
Internal
jealousy.
It depends upon your relationship with that person. Yeah.
So it, at times, you know, when do we feel jealous? The jealousy comes from you value something. You have to have value for that thing that somebody else has. If you have no value for that, you won't be jealous of the person. You have value for something that somebody has, right? And you see that that person has more than what you have, but you have value for it.
Yeah. So, I mean, in a very mundane way, somebody is richer than you, and you value that money and you
say. So then you have jealousy, right? What is the first reaction that we have from jealousy?
You feel bad about yourself.
You first depreciate yourself further in some way.
I wish I
now,
could do that.
Yeah. First you can say, in fact, I wish I could do that is still okay. Because you want that, right? But what happens is, because that person makes you feel what? Even smaller.
Yes.
In the presence of that person, you feel even smaller. Your inferiority complex what?
Okay.
Comes, increases. So, how do you handle that? Generally, by putting the other person,
that person down.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, she may be good at this, but she's bad at 1, 2, 3, more.
Exactly. Or, what's the big deal? Right?
Yeah.
So, that means you fight, because you can't tolerate yourself as small. So now, what is the way you handle it? Put the other person down so that
you put yourself down.
You can't stand it.
Then you have to level it.
You have to put the other person down. This is almost like a defense mechanism. And it all
or
happens
you run away
fast.
From that situation.
That's what. Yeah, exactly. Some kind of a defense mechanism not to. Right? So
okay.
Now,
I mean, I'm trying to ask exactly opposite situation,
yes.
That somebody is jealous of you and he's trying to push you down or pull you down. You are in your samatva. Still, there is that attack happening over and over again. How do you handle that?
That's a good question, right? How do you handle it? One thing is very important to recognize that we are not asking anybody to be passive. Please understand, right? Generally people think that being spiritual means you let people be what they are, right? And then you don't retaliate. What we say is you need not retaliate, but you need to address.
Mm-hmm.
You need to address the problem, right? You can't just ignore the problems and say, oh, I'm now spiritual, so let people be who they are. No. So there is a difference between retaliating and addressing proactively any problem. Okay? How, if you were to address the problem, what would you do? What is the healthiest way to address the problem?
Can I say, let's suppose same situation.
Yeah.
When I'm noticing that.
Yeah.
That, but then I feel if I'm noticing that, then there is something that I need to work at my level.
Yeah, but you know.
That is disturbing me.
That's true. you need to first ask yourself a question. I'm noticing it. Is it something which is based on reality, or am I creating my own picture? That is the first question you ask for yourself.
Yes.
Right? Now, it's not that every time you are projecting, please understand.
Yeah.
Right? There are times that people are, right? It's nice.
Correct.
Please don't think that every time we are only projecting.
Every time it's our fault only.
Only. Right?
No, I'll give you an example. Many people who are not in the management field, they will, you know, bring it down. This is this MBA, Mane Badda Aavade Che kind of people.
Yeah.
And they make fun, they scoff at you. It doesn't bother me.
Yeah.
Because they are...
They are like
they don't appreciate you very much because they think that MBA banaya isliye he is earning a lot of money which he may not deserve, which may be true also, you know, in the sense that cost and reward are independent of each other. Somebody might spend a lot of effort in becoming a Shastriya music, classical musician, and may not earn the money that a graduate from an MBA school might be. But that we appreciate, so I don't.
When you are confident, you don't feel anything.
We are not talking about people and their attitude. We are all talking about our distortions, right? And our, this meditation is for me, right? And it is to help.
Point was that if...
How do I handle the situation?
Exactly. So what happens is, we suffer, what we started with, we suffer from the problem because what? We are carrying that person with us instead of what? Seeing how can I address this situation? Because we sometimes what happens is either we are aggressive or we are passive aggressive. We don't address situations.
Yeah. So how do we address?
We have to learn to address situations. Right?
Okay.
So now, what do you do? What is a healthy way of addressing that situation? What? You go and you talk to that person. We never...
And objective
communication,
discussion.
Communication, how do you objectively communicate what your position is? How do you? We the whole culture and the whole teaching is you never talk about problems because then what? It can flare up.
Yeah.
And we are so afraid of it ending up in a fight that we actually never communicate anything. But by not communicating,
either you fight or you keep,
or
quiet.
You keep quiet, right? So this is where we say effective communication. Okay? Now, how does one start this effective communication? If you go and you enter this person and said, you are like this, you have been jealous of me and you are constantly attacking, what do you think the person is going to say? Attack you back.
Counter-attack.
Counter-attack. So this is totally
useless.
Counterproductive. Right? So therefore, you have to engage the person, right? In a some way that there is a dialogue, right? So this is where do you start? If you start by accusing the other, there is no possibility of a dialogue.
Very
and
good.
In fact, there is not even 100% truth in that. Why? Because you can be projecting without even knowing it, right? So when you communicate, you have to start and you have to talk about yourself. Instead of saying, you're like that, what do you say? I feel like this. Because there is 100% truth in that. What you feel is what you feel. You can even add, I could be wrong. I could be wrong, but the way I perceive it, this is what it is. Okay? Please don't underestimate the power of truth. Okay? Men, truth. And the power, this is where I keep saying that please, that implicit assumption that this world is dead, this is all dead, it's not mechanical, there is an intelligent being pervading everything. Once you change that and you go by your conviction, you will see that the world helps you, the universe helps you, because now you have decided to do things differently. Out of your understanding. So you can go and you can say that this is how I feel, then you start the dialogue. Okay? Now, there are two possibilities. Once you go genuinely the person will respond. That's one possibility. And hopefully you'll be able to talk about the problems that you have not been talking about. The second thing is, still the person will not even respond. That is a possibility, please understand.
Yes.
It's not that every time, because you start with proper intention and you say things properly, the person will always respond. If the person does not respond, then what is your option?
Leave it at that.
Leave it at that, right? Because if the person doesn't, is not ready, you can't
There's nothing you can do.
But at least you feel that you tried. In that proper attempt, which is a well thought of attempt, itself comes a lot of freedom.
Yes? Sometimes the person is that way with everybody. So you accept that it's, that you have been taking it personally, but actually it could be the person's nature and is behaving similarly with everybody.
Yeah.
But you are like taking it personally. When you realize it's a universal phenomena,
yeah.
Does it help?
Yes.
It reduces
exactly.
Your...
See, one thing is, in no human relations, you know, people give in the name of spirituality, you have to be kind, you have to be compassionate, you have to be caring. What our teacher said is, all this is true, but your kindness, your compassion, your love for others, it comes with boundaries. It has to come with boundaries. This much and no more. Because you also have to, what? Protect yourself.
Right? I have a question on this.
Yeah.
There was a case of a man who was a, you know, what is that called? He was a criminal. He kept on committing crime. And he was in jail forever, for life. And his mother would visit him every Tuesday. Because that was the day allowed to visit. And then somebody asked him, why do you do this? That's what a mother does. There are no limits to her kindness. So I don't understand this limitation.
Yeah. So the limitation is that, I will give you an example. Okay? And this is a real life example. When we were in Bangkok, we met one young girl in her early 20s, and her uncle brought her to us, and she said she is highly disturbed, so then we talked to her. Okay? So when we spoke to her, she told us that she was in an abusive relationship. Her boyfriend was actually physically abusing her. Okay? And she herself is studying what? Social sciences and all that. So she's very aware, right? She's very aware. She's an educated girl. She's not non-educated. She's gone to the US to study and everything from a wealthy family. And her boyfriend was abusing her. So I said, how did you, and I said, for how many years? She says, many years, 2-3 years he was abusing her. I said, why did you let him abuse you? You're an educated person. She said that every time he physically abused me, he would, after that, he would start crying.
Yeah.
And he said that he would say, please don't leave me, I've had a very difficult childhood, and I have seen my mother being beaten by my father, and all these impressions have stayed with me, and I really want to change, please give me some chance. Please give me some chance, because if you leave me now, then what? Again, I will fall back into even deeper into my problems and all that. And she had this whole sense of responsibility, you know. So it was all just this mental, what, manipulation.
It's a trap.
It's a trap. And you think you're being kind, you think you're being compassionate, and you feel responsible. That if I leave him now, then what? He will be, even I will be responsible for what?
There are so many such stories.
Absolutely. So this is where it is intelligent living. Please don't, in this relative world, there are no absolutes. There are no absolutes. The whole world is what? Mithya. In that, the whole world is relative.
No, but this is a difficult question. One way of her being kind to him is to leave him, so that he will gain control over himself. Or he might go down. Now if he goes down, she is going to feel responsible.
No, there, when the person has reached that level, the person needs medical help. You can't. You really cannot. You don't over assume responsibilities.
True.
Right? So that means if you really care for that person, you have to connect that person to a medical help. The person, the right person can help that person. Right?
Yeah.
And then if the person is not using one's free will
or
to
not
help
willing
oneself, then you have no responsibility. Really you don't. But you are helping, you're not just leaving. You offer your help, trying to connect that person to somebody who can really help. Right? You don't get abused by people in no relationship actually.
That is real care, what you're saying.
Yeah, that is real care because the person needs a different type of care. Okay? So this is where we say that is what we call intelligent living. Intelligent living means you have to navigate. And in fact, if you allow others to abuse you, you are violating what? Dharma of ahimsa. Because ahimsa, non-violence, is not only for others, it is also for yourself. If you don't protect yourself, who will?
Like, if others perform ahimsa on you, that is also adharma.
So that means it is adharma, but then you draw your
boundaries. If you don't protect yourself, it is adharma.
Exactly. So therefore, after having talked to this person, and if the person is not what?
Changing,
you can actually, you know,
separate out.
Yourself. Yeah, I mean, create your safe distance. Okay? Because it's not like, oh yeah, now I'm spiritual, so I have to be loving towards it. All these are pipe dreams. Okay? These are no, there is no reality to it, there is no wisdom to it. Was Lord Krishna telling Arjuna, oh, forgive all your brothers and let them be who they are. You just have to be loving. What was he saying?
Empowering the bad.
Yeah. You're empowering somebody who's doing wrong by giving him a license where you are put in a position that you can defy. You have to do that. The whole dharma has to be re-understood. Please understand. This is
many times, we wear that false feeling that we are so good, and in that goodness we allow.
Yeah, for instance, many mothers get, get a bad reaction from their children and they keep on tolerating.
Exactly. And you have to teach, and sometimes those kids, if they are not checked, the way they treat their spouses,
yeah.
You know, you allow to what?
Propagate
these wrong values.
I have a question which kind of brings us back to your original question.
Yes.
Which was, how do I cultivate a good self-image without crossing some kind of line of egoism?
Yes, exactly.
And it seems we're exploring sort of a negative of that, which is,
How to
protect myself in cases where I want to be compassionate and charity begins at home, etc.
Yes.
So, and you began to talk about you see someone, they are better in some respect, might be projection, but if it's not, then you may feel that it is, you get a deeper inferiority complex and then you start pulling them down.
No.
And then you started saying something about mithya and, that is, you obviously want to start by saying, so this is person who is higher than you. You're feeling a bit pulled down because you see that they're higher than you and you try to pull them down. And then you said something about mithya. The first step would be to start thinking about, is this real, is this not? That's the projection or not, right?
Yeah. See, that's what I'm, in fact, then many people started asking different questions, so I was replying to them. So mithya, I'm not really bringing here.
Okay, sorry.
So let's cancel that mithya. What we are saying is, you really need to, instead of putting the person down, you re-look at the whole problem, okay? What is it that you are interested in? What is it that you are interested in?
Feel
good about yourself.
And
okay?
Peace.
So that means, and if this accomplishment is important for you, what is the best way for you to handle it? Make an effort yourself to be who you want to be. By putting somebody down, how is it going to help you to achieve what you want to achieve?
I say.
So, it's not about saying, it's about putting your efforts in the right direction. If this is something that I value, if I begin to make an effort in getting that, I'm moving much more closer to that goal that I want to do, then what? By criticizing somebody else, I'm creating a distortion. It is actually making me further away from what I want to be rather than working towards what I want to be.
This, you know, I when you say that, you know, there's a little bit about, you know, that a kind of a dilemma pops up, which is about will versus skill. Or to put it differently, suppose I realize that Surya has got an attribute which I value a lot.
Yeah.
I want to put my best efforts to acquire that competence.
Yeah.
However, as I'm on that path, I realize, look, I just don't have it in me. He's maybe inborn, or he's worked really, really hard, and I am not willing, or I cannot work that hard. So I then I'm back to that place where he's higher. I put my best efforts,
and I still cannot get there.
Yeah.
And this is something, you know, like for example, this Mozart movie that you see, Amadeus, and there was this whole movie is that this Mozart is a genius, and then there is his competitor who feels that no matter how much I try, I can never be that as a genius, right? So this is why there is a, but you have to then say that by being jealous, how is it helping me? Because what are you interested in is your well-being, right? By creating further distortions, first you don't have skill, now you're creating what? Additional distortion in addition to lack of skill, what are you creating?
Jealousy.
Okay? And jealousy means you put people
down. No, it may not be jealousy. I think what Malay is saying is feeling of inadequacy.
Yeah. So that means that you continue to what? Go deeper into what? Instead of pulling yourself out, you keep on going deeper into this inadequacy.
But
you are actually behaving against yourself. Once you realize that I am interested in my well-being, but by being that, I'm countering.
Yes.
I'm going against myself. I'm getting further deeper into this inferiority complex.
Yes. Yes.
If I say what you mean.
Or if I put another way, that there are two choices. One is I'm a non-Vedantic person, or I have not heard this knowledge. So what I will do is I'll try to pull that other person down. Let's say I poison Mozart. I'm sure that didn't happen, but I poison him.
It did happen.
Okay, great. I kill him, and then I remove the object of my jealousy, and I feel good. And there is some utility in that. I feel a bit happier that at least there's not that person staring at me every day. The flip side is I could say, let me block my jealousy. Let me try to figure out a way to stop the jealousy. And I know that there is a shortcoming that I have relative to this person, but I've got to channel it somewhere else.
Exactly. And this is what, in fact, that person then, after eliminating Mozart, he suffers from tremendous guilt, right? I mean, that person dies miserable because you think that you can get away. This is where we say the whole law, okay? That you, once you have seen that you have corrected your vision of how the world is, it's not a dumb world, right? There are laws at work, and every choice that you make has a consequence, and you can't get away from the laws of Ishvara, then you will automatically make more responsible choices because you are interested ultimately in your well-being. By transgressing dharma, there is no real well-being.
But aren't we all unique individuals?
So yes, so that is, there is another way of looking at it by saying that there is this whole creation where each one is endowed with different talents, different skills. Okay? There is no point in comparing yourself with the other because whatever skill set you have, right, within that, you can always what? Improve, and you can better yourself, you can what? Enhance whatever. You need not compare yourself with anybody else. Comparison doesn't really take you anywhere.
No, but if you are in a particular field, as yes. in music or in athletics, comparison is bound to be there, right? But the point that I appreciate is that you've done your best.
Exactly.
And you've gone as far as that.
If your focus is proactively getting what you want, your psyche, please understand, your psyche is transformed from being dissatisfied to what? Proactively getting what you want. In that process of change of psyche, the outcomes are different. Please understand that. These are subtle but very profound changes.
Say for example,
instead of taking it as competition, if it is, if I code it with him better way, does it help in that way?
And once, that's a good way also, once you understand that the whole manifestation is nothing but Ishwara, right, then you can actually be very happy.
Yeah.
Right? That somebody's
doing something very well.
You can really be happy. Saying that, my God, what a glory of Ishwara. See, this person is representing something which is so beautiful. Right? That's why. If you are full, if you have good self-esteem, you can actually enjoy other people's
exactly. And also
without feeling small about yourself. Okay? And you can have a good self-esteem when you connect yourself with Ishwara. Because everything is manifestation of that one reality.
True.
And you have unique place in the scheme of things. You are endowed with unique talents. Like, you know, as I give the example of a car, every part of the car has a place. A small wire somewhere out there and a big engine, each one has its place. If the wire says that, okay, I'm not this big engine and I'm this little wire, what, you know, but if it doesn't do the job that it has to do, the whole car will break down. Okay. Surya says, give a more dynamic example of, let's say, the musical symphony.
Because or life example. Because I thought the example of the car has one limitation, which is that it looks like it's mechanical. So if you take a human body, for example,
yes.
or a cell or an animal, so you bring this idea of, yeah, it connects more with your experience as a human.
Or a musical symphony. Yeah. Where everybody has to play a part.
And right? If one person makes a mistake, the whole
harmony of the whole thing goes. Right? So that means a self-esteem comes from re-understanding the reality of what the world is. Right? Yesterday in a class I gave an example that if a wave thinks that I'm only a wave and everything else is external to me, then what is the attitude of the wave?
To protect itself.
To protect itself against all the external forces, right? But if the same wave sees oneself as there is only one ocean and every wave is part of the same ocean, right? And each one has its own place within the ocean.
Ocean is incomplete without the wave.
The ocean will be incomplete without every wave. Each wave brings in what? Its own uniqueness, right? Once you see yourself, and is it positive thinking? It is based on realities. It is a fact. Just shifting your vision. Just shifting your vision based on what is. Okay? So if you are part of this whole scheme of things and you are endowed with your own unique skills, abilities, right, your talents, there is so much you can do with that. Okay? And if you can pay attention to what can I do with my unique talents, then that you're much more you're using your energies what? In a proactive manner, in constructively using what you have. The minute you start comparing yourself with others, you act against yourself.
Point, if I understand, is you have to all the time think in terms of what can I contribute.
Yeah, exactly. And see yourself as not fighting against the world. This world, you are a
part of the world.
You are the participant in the world. You participate with all your talents and skills, what? To shape the world. That capacity is given to you. And that is the most healthy way to what? Have a good self-esteem.
Absolutely.
It is not based on, oh yeah, I should just focus on my talent. See yourself as part of this grand scheme of things, and it's given certain powers to shape the world. And use those talents. Use that free will.
Yeah.
That's how you get good self-esteem. Otherwise, it's all just I continue to feel I'm isolated, and then I said, okay, this person is higher, so I look at somebody lower and said, oh, I'm good relative to this person. Huh. That is not
that's
real.
Not
that's
real.
Not really. People say, if you feel that you're not rich enough by looking at the millionaire, look at the poor people. And then with relative to those poor people, you are well off. This is not a good way to feel good about yourself.
Feeling of wrong content.
Yeah. Right? What we are saying is, readjust your thinking in keeping with realities. Okay? You are a very essential part of the world. The world is not complete without you. Right? And with your unique talents and all, if your focus is on how to use it to contribute and also to grow as a person, the whole focus changes. You are bound to have healthy self-esteem.
Sure.
Okay? Where you acknowledge your talents. This is when my teacher said, acknowledge your talents but attribute it to Ishvara. When you say that, thank you for giving me all these talents, then what? You are not proud. At the same time, you don't have no self-esteem.
You have been given.
You've been given.
You didn't
so
build it.
Exactly. So that means you also acknowledge what? The presence of an order which gives you all these skills. You're connected to that order. You're connected to that Ishvara. Ishvara as an entity is a reality. A lot of our psychological health comes by what? Relating to Ishvara, not from our own imagination of Ishvara, but what Ishvara is. The body is given, the mind is given, all your talents and skills are given. You come in a world where stars are given, earth is given, the galaxies are given.
Your parents are given.
All the parents are given, siblings are given, all the necessary elements for your body to survive, everything is given. You don't even think about the world like that. You always operate from that dissatisfaction. You don't acknowledge, you don't have any gratitude for all that is given to you.
Sure.
I'm just thinking when you're saying this, it's something that as when you're born, it's something that should be, it's in your education or, you know, as parents need to tell you this, but you know, it's like this that, you know, you are born as a square, and since the world needs a, you know, round, like a circle, all your life you're just trying to shape yourself from a square into a, you know, like a circle to fit into that. So your whole life is going in trying to shape yourself to be something you're not. So, you know, it's, that's why this whole thing of...
This is why so much conflict, so much stress we accumulate,
so
much anxiety we accumulate, frustration.
You just redefine everything, and I was just thinking that, at least in India, I don't know elsewhere, but love, kindness, compassion, respect is equal to self-sacrifice.
Yeah, and that is not what
those
we are
not
talking
the
about.
Definitions of,
those are not the real definitions. That's a very, very perceptive point, you know.
Yes.
You have to, exactly. Yes. This so-called self-sacrifice is not what we are talking about. We are talking about a very dynamic way of what? Rechanneling our energies in constructive things and not being just this victim who is passive, who never say anything.
This is true, what she is saying, you know. My parent, my mother is a kartavya. I mean, this is my duty.
Yes.
What is this duty? You love me or you don't love me? It's not about your duty.
That's true.
That
whole life is lived in what? Yeah. So let's move on because I have so much to say about meditation. This is only the first point, but then everything else is very.
You have gone up to half a sentence of the full one.
Yeah, exactly. This rate will not finish for next 6 months.
No, but the point that she made is we are continuously trying to be what we are not.
Exactly.
And the parents are also continuously chopping us.
Yes.
And maybe in the adulthood, we have that chatter going on in our mind, which is our parents talking to us. Don't do this.
They didn't know better anyways.
Yeah. So this is why so much unlearning takes place when you come to Gita. This is the time that you really come in touch with yourself, the true self.
Unlearning, what you said, is very important.
Unlearning of all these behaviors, all these different ways of looking at the world, looking at things. Whole thing has to be what? Undone. And you embellish yourself with what? Proper attitudes, proper views about what is what, right? Your attitude towards yourself, about the world, about the people living in it. Everything has to undergo a very major transformation. But it is not just a superficial or positive or anything. It is based on seeing the realities, right? And incorporating those realities in your psyche and undo your construction of the world and be in touch with what is.
I'm sorry, I just wanted to react to the point made there. So, does this mean that for... So, I'm just trying to figure out round, square, self-sacrifice, love, compassion, kindness, that involves that. But could you also think of it this way? I mean, just to your point about relativistic world, that I do need to sacrifice, for instance, my time, my energy to demonstrate love or kindness in the world. And I think the point you're trying to make is that it should not be driven by others' expectations. And what I think you're saying is it should be driven rather by some kind of different rubric or a different sort of acid test, which is my desire and my ability to see beyond mithya. Is that...
Okay, that's a very good point. Because that whole karma yoga, that's a very good point, Malai. Because the whole point of karma yoga is what? The first aspect of karma yoga is nishchayatmika. What am I really looking for in life? Okay? That moksha that I'm looking for cannot be gained through what? Achieving anything in this world. Okay? Knowing my true nature, because I'm making a fundamental error about my true nature. So if I want to know my true nature, that becomes what? One of the major pursuits of my life. Then if knowing is the end, then what is the place of karma? The very place of karma is to what? Give me the maturity so that I can gain this knowledge. So that means when I'm engaging in the world, generally I do engage in the world for what? Okay. My own gratification, we say gratification of raga and dvesha. Okay? I get what I like and I avoid what I don't like. So I'm constantly manipulating external forces.
There are feelings of love coming into all this.
No, but I think if we talk about everything all at the same time, then we just don't get anywhere. So let's just stay with one idea and let's examine it, right? Because he's asking a very interesting question. Because otherwise, you have everything together, you can't know anything, right? So, now, the second point is, how do I use karma, right, to get rid of distortions? That is the second thing. So now, let's say that when I engage in the world, then what? Let's say there is jealousy. Then what now? What do I do? Before, what did I do? I had all these defense mechanisms to put the person down or feel even worse about myself and all. Now, what would I do differently? I'll bring in the teaching. What is the teaching? The teaching is what? On one level, if I really want to understand what is my true nature, then my true nature is not this limited individual. This limited individual, whether it is this person or that person or that person, everybody is limited. That way there is no perfection anywhere. Okay? okay, the only way to solve my problem of inadequacy is knowing my true nature, which is much bigger than this little individuality. Okay? Then, even though this individuality is not my absolute reality, okay, it is still there with me. So now, what do I do with all the talents and all the skills that I have been given? Instead of comparing myself with somebody else, what do I do? Try to see how I can use those talents to do something significant and to grow as a human being. The whole focus becomes different.
Right. So you could be doing, to your point, you could be doing the same action. Let us say a beggar comes to the door and you feel that it's expected of you to give the, you know, some alms, and you decide to give the alms. On the other hand, in my case, let's say, I decide to go to a parent-teacher meeting because I know it's expected of me, the teacher is expecting, my wife is expecting that I show up at the parent-teacher meeting. That might be a demonstration of love driven by expectation. On the other hand, if I somehow can connect it, if I be a better parent by attending this meeting, I am developing myself, I am nurturing others.
Excellent.
So I was just trying to resolve this issue, the same action, but different mindset.
Perspective. You look at it in a different perspective.
Yes, exactly. So
it's,
that might
it's a lovely thing, what he's saying is so important, because that's what makes everything into a karma yoga. Right? Otherwise, you are just, I'm duty bound, right? I have to somehow, I have this office, but somehow I have to take this half an hour off because, you know, I'm a good parent and I have to just do it. That's not what makes you into a karma yogi, right? What he's saying is, by spending and giving this time to my child, I'm enhancing
My parenting.
Yeah.
And that's where there is love coming. Love comes in here.
Yeah. It comes
for yourself and for the others.
Yeah, for the others.
So it is not so much a question of duty. It's a question of contribution, where through contribution you feel good about yourself.
Exactly.
In fact, I would be more accurate than that. I would say from a sense of this duty I must, something imposed upon you. Here, what is your shift is, I am choosing to do that in the light of my understanding of this bigger perspective.
Okay. Right.
Where to live. See?
Yes.
It's a huge shift. Huge, but huge. Tremendous.
Well, in duty, we are saying that I am benefiting the other person. Yeah. But actually, in this, both, unless there is benefit for both.
Which exactly.
Then only it works. Otherwise, then those words like sacrifice, because in the end, don't.
There is a burden.
Self-imposed. You feel as though you are burdened by your sense of duty.
Yeah. So instead of a burden, it is something that you are enjoying.
Pleasurable. Yeah. Pleasurable because you see the importance of that act. Exactly. And the importance of that act and the contribution of that act, but by taking care of your child, how many people are you benefiting? By giving the right values, like right attention and all, a healthy child, when that child grows up and interacts with the world, how many people are going
and
to benefit
by
from
going to the
child?
Parent-teacher association meeting, they are also contributing to other parents,
yes,
and to the school, and to their children.
I feel that, correct. Everything, when there is contribution, you feel happy.
Absolutely. And
but out of your own volition,
yeah, exactly. And that comes when you recognize that we are all what? Creators of our future. Our personal future and our joint future. Okay?
Sure.
That power is given to you. And we hardly use that power, and we spend so much time on complaining.
Cribbing.
And cribbing.
So, I mean, in Sanskrit or Gujarati, there is a word which is called Svayam Spurna. So, whatever comes from within is what?
With proper understanding of what it is.
Without distortions.
And that is something which makes your whole life a pleasurable life. It is.
So this is the whole thing about here and now.
Yeah.
Be there.
Yeah.
Not why should I be here, why can't I be somewhere else. You are there.
Yeah, and
do your best.
Yeah. Right? So this is how, this is a very, very fundamental shift. Please understand that unless all these shifts take place, this I am the whole and all will not do anything. Okay? All these what contribute to your understanding and living that vision. There is a connect. So now, the meditation we still haven't
done. This is I think we are clearing the distortions.
Yeah, that's true. So this is why Vedanta class... Vedanta class is never about finishing the text. Because it's always about...
Clarifying
things. And there are levels and levels and levels of confusion, so the teacher is not in a hurry, and hopefully student is also not in a hurry to finish the text. It's just what? Removing our distortions, within distortions, so that you have clarity.
We feel happy when we understand something also.
Yeah, you feel happy, right? There is amazing pleasure when you are in touch.
It's like
when you
help you catch.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, now what is the time? 7.
Can we,
okay.
I mean, even briefly go through the rest of it?
Exactly.
So, we haven't finished this.
No, exactly. Okay. Now, the whole rest of it is all very this thing.
Complex.
Okay? Yeah, so, prana, prano, samokrutva, nasya, abhyantara, charino means your what? Breathing in and out and calming yourself.
Yes, like you said.
Okay. Yatendriya, mano, buddhihi. Munir Moksha Parayana. Okay? That is what Malai was saying. The whole change of priority is what? Moksha Parayana. My priority is what? Knowing myself. Knowing myself, which is already the whole. Okay? Otherwise, retaining this little individuality, I'm trying to become the whole. It's impossible. And I'm always dissatisfied. But I am already the whole, and I need to know my true nature. So that becomes the pursuit, and then what? The day-to-day activity is to prepare oneself for this knowledge. That is a shift. So therefore, there is no need for comparison, right? The comparison is what? When I'm trying to get fulfillment from things. Now what am I saying? The engagement with the world will give me an opportunity to recognize my distortions and to remove those distortions. So even if jealousy comes, what will happen? Now I at least begin to understand that this is a distortion I've been carrying.
Okay.
And when a situation brings about that emotion, how do you take it? Now it's an opportunity for me to get over this distortion. So how can I re-understand this whole situation in a better light? Okay? So that means what I will say, that I can actually be happy about people's achievements. I can be really happy, and I can, in fact, the more you can say, this is lovely. If somebody's looks, you're feeling jealous because you're feeling small. You go and you tell this person
you're looking very good.
Do that, because that's really how you feel. That is based on truth.
True.
And when you say that, that smallness goes away. You confront that smallness. You don't go along with that smallness.
True.
You become beautiful.
Then
you become
the
person.
And the person smiles and the person says, thank you, your whole
you
reality changes.
You,
yeah? You start smiling. Whenever you feel jealous, instead of putting the person down, you actually go and compliment the person. Because actually you admire.
True. Yeah.
So you change. You remove that don't act out of that smallness. Act out of what?
Out of what you originally felt.
Originally, because your real feeling is you like this, what the person is, you like it, go and you compliment. And that is not flattery, it is based on reality.
So we need to speak even to ourselves directly.
Yeah.
We were saying, like, I was jealous, but as you said, actually what we are saying is that person is beautiful.
Beautiful. And then you go and you actually express it to that person. Your whole reality will change. That small individual, insecure individual, which rules you, will have no place anymore. Because you act out of your wisdom and you don't act out of this what? Small, dissatisfied person who's sitting within you and making you do what? All the things which are not.
Yeah.
You know that they are not.
Self-enhancing.
Because, so you see, in some ways when people are in pain, right, why sometimes we keep on talking about it, we think that we are giving sympathy, but actually at times we didn't have some pleasure.
Really that
yeah.
You are not in that.
We are not at least. Yeah, that I'm suffering, but others are also suffering, right?
Well, thank God I didn't get it.
Yeah, exactly. So all these distortions you really have to remove because they are very, very deep, deep emotions. And you need to recognize them and you have to act differently. Not from this smallness, but from what you understand. The whole revised understanding of the world. That's why it takes time.
And Nima, your experience and Surya, your experience is that regular meditation, as described in this chapter, helps with recognizing and expressing and resolving these distortions.
Okay, let me ask you,
okay.
Factual question. How long do you meditate and when do you meditate?
Every morning? Every day in the morning.
For how long?
How long?
Depends. Minimum, let's say 20 minutes. It can go.
And you do pranayama.
Let's see, then I have also, you have to know what is meditation first. Then I will reply to that. Because there is a whole set of practice.
Okay.
Then I can ask you, is contemplation, do you include that in meditation?
Yes.
When I'm doing some chanting, are you including that in meditation? Sometimes I'm doing some also movement or meditative movement. Is it included in meditation or not? See, so then where do you define meditation? So we need to know more. But the formal sitting, let's say
hand
mobile, I will say like half an hour, 2-45 minutes. Then all the rest will add up to that. Every day, regularly.
So this is where it says, you revisit, because all of us are within us holding what? Bhaya krodaha. Bhaya is fears.
Fear.
And krodha is anger.
Fears
and anger, these are certain things, actually no human being is free
out
of. Okay? So that means that all these things that are staying within us, generally when we are young, what do the parents tell us? Good boys don't get angry. That means you have anger, but now what?
Suppress.
You have to suppress because you want to be good. Okay? So that means it is there unaddressed, suppressed. And it remains within. Then, over a period of time, how many times you are angry as a child? One time? So many times. And all this is all bottled up here. Anger. Unexpressed. Because good girls and good boys don't get angry. Then what happens? All this anger, as you become an adult. And you, in fact, we are so uncomfortable with our anger, we learn not to address it or to even acknowledge it.
Mm.
So you just want to push it aside.
Or express it in a manner which is hurtful to others.
Right. So when you keep on pushing it aside and then it's still there, then what? An external trigger happens
yeah.
and you lose that control and what happens? because every time you are not able to
hold and it. That expression hurts other people.
And that expression hurts so many people.
Because it's a kind of a blast.
Exactly. Right? So now in meditation, what do you do? You release, exactly. It's a very, very at a deep level. When you have gained a certain absorption, this is the time that you actually release everything that is all deep within you. And how do you release it? First, you have to acknowledge. First, you have to acknowledge that it is there. And nobody is free from it. Nobody is free from it. Okay? So you have to acknowledge. You have to stay with your anger, your sadness, your fear, that enough of trying to avoid it.
Oh.
Mm.
Right? So you say, this is there. Then, very often, if you really look at your psyche, yeah, what situations which make you angry, when you begin to note down, you will find that there is a common thread.
Pattern, yeah.
Common pattern. Okay? And in those common patterns, there are some implicit assumptions. Okay? Unless you come to know all those implicit assumptions which happen what automatically over a period of 2 minutes, you've given yourself a whole series of reasoning, right? And then it has burst into anger. Examine those series of reasoning. Stay with your reasoning. Ask yourself, challenge yourself,
Anger may be genuine.
In fact, somebody said that people may be who they are, right? And as I said, you need not be very lovable, you can keep your distance, but at the same time, you need not get angry. Getting angry doesn't accomplish anything. You hurt others, and you also hurt yourself. Because right after the expression of anger, how do you feel about yourself?
But anger comes out of weakness.
No, what I'm saying is, what does anger come out of? Tell me. What does anger come out of?
Your ego is hurt.
No, weakness. Not getting your way.
Not getting your way or not getting what you want.
Exactly. Right? So that means, this is where you say, when you have illusion of control, okay, you think that you control everything. You think, right? And when things don't happen according to your wishes, then what happens?
You get angry.
I'm saying that weakness.
When you use a word called weakness, what is this weakness? We don't know what. See, you give a vague kind of a reasoning and you don't know, you are not pinpointing anything.
Weakness of ego, weakness of money, weakness of own health, whatever. Health is a weakness. Anger is, money is weakness. Then suppose he is unable to control his class, so he becomes angry just to control the class.
So that's what she's saying. What we are saying is
control is the weakness. I consider that.
There is no weakness or anything.
It means incapacity to have your way.
Exactly. Right? This is exactly what I'm saying. You feel that you're controlling.
She spills the milk. 2 liters of milk, she spills. Right? I don't have money to buy milk. So I will get angry on her because I don't have money. Therefore, I will bring money for you. So money is my weakness. I understand that.
So that way, you can be angry towards the whole world because there is so much wastage. They throw away so many dairy products, but all wastage after the expiry date. And there are so many people who don't have milk. So all that creates just a lot of anger. We are not talking about all of that. We are just talking about what causes anger in us is what? I feel that I have control. And actually, the reality is, I don't control. So when things don't happen my way, then what happens? Just keep it, because when you create this thing of weak, then you're labeling yourself further, I'm weak. There's nothing, don't try to analyze rather than give more new names. and more labeling. Because before I thought I'm angry, now I also think I'm weak. So I keep on giving myself new and new self-depreciating names. Try to understand where are the distortions and undo the distortions. This is the healthiest way. Okay? What leads to anger is an illusion of control. What now do I understand? That I don't really control. The results are what? Are they decided by me? No. Are they taken care of just randomly?
No.
No. There is an order. So if there is an order, which is what? The time frame of that order is much larger than my little understanding. Naturally, how will be my response to the results which are not in keeping with what I expected?
Relaxed,
because I have confidence in the working of the world. Because otherwise, I'll always say, oh, now I'm weak. No, there are distortions in understanding. At the deep level of meditation, what do you need to do? You need to re-understand all these implicit assumptions with which you are living, which themselves are false. Because unless you do that job, Vedanta will not work. Because the deep psyche has a completely different assumptions, and the actions are done from those assumptions, and any wisdom that is gained is what? In one corner. So there is no integration. In meditation gives you that opportunity to what? Reprogram yourself, reorient yourself.
And therefore, you have to do it every day.
Yeah.
Because throughout the day, things are happening which you have to get over.
And you need to re-understand, because we have habitual way of looking at things, and now we have a new vision of things. So what is going to prevail? What is going to prevail? Your habitual way of looking at the things, the world and yourself and your situations, or what you have learned during 1 week, 1 hour in Gita class?
Habitual.
Yeah.
Therefore you have to do meditation.
Therefore you need to stay with these ideas. And you need to incorporate these ideas in your decision making. And you need to reprogram what? Certain implicit assumptions which are based on what? Your past experiences and not this new knowledge. Unless you do that, and that is done, because you know when you're in waking, when you're just, your mind operates at a superficial, but in meditation it gains a certain depth. If you do reprogramming at that level, it works wonders. That means whatever you have relearned and re-looked at in terms of your anger, in terms of your sadness, in terms of your fears, everything, you re-understand. Certain assumptions are wrong, you replace them by what? The right knowledge. Once you have done that, then when you are not meditating and you are transacting with the world, the chances that the wisdom will prevail are much higher than if you have not done this job at a deep level.
Deep level is, you mean, subconscious.
And you know, because in meditation, as I will show you next time, there are some techniques which take you not at a superficial running of the mind, at a certain depth. I will talk about it. What leads to that depth, I will talk about it.
You will talk about it, or you will also demonstrate?
Yeah, we can demonstrate. Surya is very good in meditation.
We should go through these.
Surya is excellent.
You're doing it in class, right? Half an hour.
Yeah.
He is mastering meditation. He's so good.
And
most
of the students enjoy it.
They love it.
Surya.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They love it. They want more.
Yeah.
So I have to find ways to be.
They want to meditate during the whole class 70 minutes.
Maybe shorter sessions, like 5-10 minutes before every class or something like that. You have to find a way.
So it's 7:30.
I think I have a request. Next time, let's spend more time on this one.
Meditation.
So we decide to keep quiet and let her.
Okay.
They have not started even.
Yeah, so no. We will stop the class here. But you see the need for meditation. It's not just concentration or thoughtlessness. It's a very deep level of working and reorienting.
Sometimes this thing happens when you're asleep also.
Yeah, that's true. That the
mind works.
So when will you do on 3rd?
Yeah, now I will
date with Badle.
Yes. Om Purnamadav Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Om Shri Guru.